we light this Christ candle, a living symbol of the one life in which we all live and move and have our being. When Elizabeth drew her first breath, life came flooding into a new way of being. The breath said, "Observe me and learn to live in the present moment. Feel me and know the ebb and flow of life. Move with me," said the breath, "and I'll invite your very being to dance. Make sounds with me, and I shall teach your heart to sing. Follow me," said the breath, "and I'll lead you out to the farthest reaches of the universe, and inward to the deepest parts of your being." Each time I come, said the breath, I am the gift of life. And yet now I am released without regret, suffering, or fear. For you, Elizabeth, have lived a life of service to your fellow beings. Well done, good and faithful servant. The universe breathes me into you. You send me back to the universe. I am the flow of life between every single part of you and all that is. Amen.
A reading from Luke chapter 12. The Lord answered, "Who are faithful and wise servants? Who are the ones the master will put in charge of giving the other servants their food supplies at the proper time? Servants are fortunate if their master comes and finds them doing their job. A servant who is always faithful will surely be put in charge of everything the master owns. But suppose one of the servants thinks that the master won't return until late. Suppose that servant starts beating all the other servants and eats and drinks and gets drunk. If that happens, the master will come on a day and at a time when the servant least expects him. That servant will then be punished and thrown out with the servants who cannot be trusted. If servants are not ready or willing to do what their master wants them to do, they will be beaten hard. But servants who don't know what their master wants them to do will not be beaten so hard for doing wrong. If God has been generous with you, he will expect you to serve him well. But if he has been more than generous, he will expect you to serve him even better."
Thank you.
With a profound sense of loss, the royal family and the nation is now in a period of mourning. Whether one is a royalist or not, the Queen was certainly someone who inherited a role she neither sought nor was expected to inherit. But because of her personal qualities and character, she has been widely respected and indeed loved for the way she embodied it. It is quite clear that she took the words of our gospel reading to heart in a very personal way. As the old translations had it, to whomsoever much has been given, much will be required. In action, in word, and in deed, a wonderful example of the Christian life was led. It is for these reasons, I suspect, that even though the Queen may not have been part of our immediate family, many of us have grown up with her. Hence, our sense of loss and our grieving. Of course, the vast majority of people grieving or acknowledging the Queen's passing will have never met her in person. Grieving someone is about reflecting on our lifetime connection and the attachment we have had with them that no longer physically exists. During her 70-year reign, she's been part of our lives, part of our grandparents' lives, part of our parents' lives, and now ours and our children's. Think of these as cross-generational connections. We, collectively, and across the generations, feel as if we know her. Globally, we've also been preparing for her loss. Inevitably, her advanced age, health issues, and plans for what happened after her death have been the subjects of endless media coverage. The Queen's death has prompted public displays of grief around the world. From public gatherings at Buckingham Palace in London, at St Giles Cathedral in Edinburgh, and condolences from world leaders, to individuals reflecting on social media about what she meant to them. So this familiarity, you could call it, means the type of grief we are seeing now can feel very similar to having someone in our own lives close to us and then losing them. By helping to acknowledge and understand how we feel the way we do, we can then look to the example of the Queen's life and work through how we follow that example. There's a lovely story which tells of the son of a rabbi who mourned the death of his beloved father. Day after day, the son went to the cemetery and threw himself on the grave of his father. One day, as the son gave way to fits of sorrow, his father appeared to him in a vision. His father said to him, "My son, do you think that you honour my memory with your grief? Offer me no tributes of tears. Build for me no monuments of sorrow. Do not weep for me. Live for me. Show your love by obedience to God's commandments, by devotion to faith, and by service to your fellow human beings. This, said his father's vision, is the memorial that truly honours the departed. So after hearing these words, the son lifted himself from his father's grave and went forth to make of his father's memory a perpetual light to guide him on paths of righteousness and truth. The story tells us that the rabbi gave his son a gift when he told him to keep living by honouring his father's memory through his deeds. We can assume that the son left the cemetery to pursue life and to bring honour to his father by doing so. We too must fulfil the meaning of our life, enriched by the memories of those who have died. Our shadow grief may linger for years, but we cannot allow it to become a stumbling block to our life. Those who remember their loved ones do so with pictures they see in their home, with a memorial plaque in temple or church, and with regular contributions of time or resources that help others know how his or her memory still inspires us to do and to be our best. All is not lost if we regard memory as the sacred gift that it is. And that's something we could all do well to reflect upon. How tangibly will we remember the Queen? Driven by a sense of duty, the Queen was guided by her strong Christian faith, which she said on many occasions informed the way she conducted her life, both personal and public. Tributes from people around the world attest to the respect and affection in which she was held well beyond our shores. She is remembered for her wisdom, her good humour, and kindness by so many she encountered. When she made everyone she met not just feel special, but feel part of her life. A remarkable life. May she rest in peace.
We light this candle in remembrance and hope to call to mind Magnus and Ronald and all the saints and all those dear to us who have gone before, especially those who have died in recent times, and as a sign of hope to future generations as yet unborn, Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life.
In the tender compassion of our God, the dawn from heaven will break upon us to shine on those who live in darkness under the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace. May you stay safe in the way of Christ, and may you be blessed by his Spirit today and always. Amen.